वॉल्यूमेट्री, वॉल्यूमेट्री वर्ड इज डिराइव्ड फ्रॉम द ग्रीक वर्ड वॉनिया मीनिंग एंगल्स एंड मेट्रन मीनिंग मेजर. इट रिफर्स टू मेजरमेंट ऑफ द एंगल्स क्रिएटेड एट द ह्यूमन जॉइंट्स बाय द बोन्स ऑफ द बॉडी. वॉल्यूमीटर इज यूज्ड टू डिटरमाइन जॉइंट पोजिशन, टू डिटरमाइन द अमाउंट ऑफ द मोशन अवेलेबल एट द जॉइंट, to determine the presence of the absence of the dysfunction, to establish the diagnosis and to developing the treatment goal, evaluating the progress and lack of the progress toward the rehabilitative goals, modifying the treatment, motivating the subject and research purpose, fabricating the orthosis. That purpose goniometry can be used. Joint motion can be divided into two parts, arthrokinematics and osteokinematics. Arthrokinematics means the movement of the joint surface like sliding, spinning and rolling. Osteokinematics means the movement of the shaft of the bones. Planes and axes. The planes have their corresponding axes. Planes lie at the right angle to each other. Axes lie at the right angle to the both planes and the other axes. There are three plane and axis in which the movements occurs. The frontal plane, axis passes is the sagittal, that is anterior posterior, and movements occur is the adduction and the abduction. The sagittal plane, the axis passes is the frontal, that is medial lateral. Movement occurs in that is flexion and the extension. The transverse plane, axis passes is the horizontal or the vertical. Movement occurs in that is the rotation. Amount of motion available at the joint is known as range of motion. There are two types of motion, active and the passive. Active range of motion is done voluntarily by the patient. Passive range of motion is performed by the therapist on the patient. Normal range of motion for the different joints are following. For the shoulder joints, movement occurs flexion, extension, abduction, medial rotation and the lateral rotation. Flexion normally 0 to 180 degree, extension 0 to 60 degree, abduction 0 to 180 degree, medial rotation 0 to 70 degree, lateral rotation will be 0 to 90 degree. For the elbow joint, flexion 0 to 150 degree. For the forearm, pronation and the supination. Pronation 0 to 80 degree, supination 0 to 80 degree. For the wrist joint, flexion, extension, radial deviation and the ulnar deviation. Flexion 0 to 80 degree, extension 0 to 70 degree, radial deviation 0 to 20 degree, ulnar deviation 0 to 30 degree. For the thumb, carpometacarpal joint, metacarpophalangeal joint and the interphalangeal joint. At the carpometacarpal joint, action will be abduction, flexion, extension and opposition. Abduction 0 to 70 degree, flexion 0 to 15 degree, extension 0 to 20 degree, opposition, tip of thumb to base or tip of the fifth digit. Metacarpophalangeal joint, flexion 0 to 50 degree. Interphalangeal joint, flexion 0 to 80 degree. For the digits, second to fifth finger metacarpophalangeal joint, flexion, hyperextension and the abduction. Flexion 0 to 90 degree, hyperextension 0 to 45 degree. Proximal IP joint, flexion 0 to 100 degree. Distal IP joint, flexion and hyperextension. Flexion 0 to 90 degree, hyperextension 0 to 10 degree. For the hip joint, movements are flexion, extension, abduction, adduction, lateral rotation and the medial rotation. Flexion 0 to 120 degree, extension 0 to 30 degree, abduction 0 to 45 degree, adduction 0 to 30 degree, lateral rotation 0 to 45 degree, medial rotation 0 to 45 degree. For the knee joint, flexion and the extension, flexion 0 to 135 degree, extension 135 to 0 degree. Ankle joint, dorsiflexion, plantar flexion, inversion and eversion. Dorsiflexion 0 to 20 degree, plantar flexion 0 to 50 degree, inversion 0 to 35 degree, eversion 0 to 15 degree. Toe, first metatarsophalangeal joint, flexion and extension, flexor 0 to 45 degree, extensor 0 to 70 degree. First interphalangeal joint, that is flexor 0 to 90 degree. Second to fifth, PIP and the DIP flexor. PIP 0 to 35 degree, DIP 0 to 60 degree. Second to fifth, metatarsal phalangeal joint, flexor and the extensor. Flexor 0 to 40 degree, extensor 0 to 40 degree. For the spine, cervical spine, thoracic spine and the lumbar thoracic spine. Cervical spine, flexion, extension, lateral flexion, rotation. Flexion 0 to 45 degree when chin touches to chest. Extension 0 to 45 degree looking at the ceiling. Lateral flexion 0 to 45 degree. Rotation 0 to 60 degree. Chin in the line with the shoulder. Thoracic spine, flexion, rotation. Flexion 0 to 50 degree, rotation 0 to 30 degree. Lumbar and thoracic spine, flexion 0 to 80 degree, extension 0 to 25 degree. Types of goniometer: universal goniometer, gravity dependent goniometer and the electrogoniometer. Universal goniometer, it most commonly used instrument for the measurement of the joint position and the motion in the clinical setting. Moreover, it is designed, it is universal because of its versatility. It can be used to measure joint position and the motion of the almost all joints of the body. This is the picture of the universal goniometer. This is stable arm and this is movable arm. Made up of metal or the plastic material. Typically, the design includes a body with thin extension called arms, sensory arm, and the moving arm. The body resembles a protector and may form a full or a half circle. Measurement scales are located on one or the both sides of the body. The scales on full circle instrument extended either from 0 to 180 degree and from 180 to 0 degree. Or from 0 to 360 degree or from 360 to 0 degree. The scales on a half circle instrument extend from 0 to 180 degree or from 180 to 0 degree. This is a half circle goniometer. Stationary arm, it is a structural part of the goniometer and cannot be moved independently of the body. Moving arm, it is attached to the fulcrum in the center of the body by screw-like device that permits arm to move freely on the body. Length of the arms varies 1 to 60 inches according to the size of the joint. Gravity dependent goniometer, it is also known as the inclinometers. They are use effect of the gravity on pointers and fluid levels to measure joint position and the motion. The pendulum goniometer consists of 360 degree protector with weighted pointer hanging from the center of the protector. Fluid goniometer has a fluid-filled circular chamber containing an air bubble. It has a 360 degree scale. Both types of the instruments are attached on the distal segment of the joint being measured. The angle between the long axis of the distal segment and the line of the gravity is measured. It is easier to be used than universal goniometer in some situations as they do not have to be aligned with the bony landmarks. Universal pendulum and the fluid goniometer should not be used interchangeably. That means examiners should not use universal goniometer on the Tuesday and pendulum goniometer on Wednesday. Electrogoniometers, they are used primarily in the research to obtain dynamic joint measurements. Most devices have two arms similar to those of the universal goniometer. A potentiometer is connected to the two arms. Changes in position cause the resistance in the potentiometer to vary. The resulting change in the voltage can be used to indicate the amount of the joint motion. Electrogoniometer resembles somehow to the pendulum goniometer. Electrogoniometers are expensive and take time to accurately calibrate and attach to the subject. Because of this drawback, they are often used in the research purposes than in the clinical settings. Factors affecting the range of motion: age, The young age group has more range of motion than the elders. Gender, it varies from region to region in the males and the females. Thoracolumbar mobility is of males is more than the female. Hip flexion is more in the females than the male. Soft tissue tightness, adhesion formation, recent injury around the joints and nervous system. Handfill, the feeling experienced by the examiner as a barrier to further motion at the end of the passive range of motion is known as handfill. The ability to determine the handfill depends on the practice and the sensitivity. Determination of the handfill should be carried out very carefully and slowly. Cyriacs and Kaltenbrunn has described normal and abnormal handfill. Normal is physiological, abnormal that means pathological handfill. Normal handfill of three types. Soft, thin, and the hard. Soft handfill, that is soft tissue approximation. For example, elbow flexion and the knee flexion. Thin handfill, structure will be muscular stretch, capsular stretch, and ligaments stretch. Muscle stretch, while hip flexion with the knee stretch. Capsular stretch, extension of the metacarpal phalangeal joint. Ligamentous stretch, forearm supination. Hard and fill, structure will be bone contacting to each other. For example, elbow extension. Abnormal and fill are of four types: soft, thin, hard, and empty. Soft structure will be it occurs sooner or the later in the range of motion than in usual. Feels boggy. Example is soft tissue edema or synovitis. Thin handfill occurs sooner or the later in the range of motion than in the usual. Example, increase the muscle tone, capsular muscular ligamentous shortening. Hard handfill structure will be bony block is felt. For example, chondromalacia, osteoarthritis, loose body in the joint, and fracture. Empty handfill, no real handfill felt as pain is the prevent reaching the end range of motion. For example, acute joint inflammation and the bursitis. Thank you.